open in prayer. We had a good week. I wanted to make an announcement here about the, I have a flyer about Easter sunrise service. This is something that Paducah Riverfront does every year, and but you have to be back here for service, because this is sponsored by Lindsay Funeral Home, but it is a, if you like to go to sunrise, April the 9th, 5:30 at the, looking out over the river there where they had the Christmas tree. I think that's where it is. And then we also have a sign-up sheet in the foyer for Trace Creek Baptist Church, the Passion play, and that's going to be on April 1st that we're going. It starts at 2 o'clock. We will leave here at 12:30. If you want to drive, or if you want to ride with, we'll be leaving here at 12:30, but sign up and let us know if you want to drive or what. So, all right, we're going to open in prayer. Robert, will you open the service? Went home Sunday night after the last night after work, and was thinking about the services Sunday and how it reminded me again that we have a covenant with the Lord, and He, you know, and the promises that He has for us, and we need to remember those when the enemy comes and makes us anxious and something happens or whatever, and we all have it every day, something's going on. And the word of the Lord stands true, and it's never a lie. So I'm going to sing, Who Breaks the Power of Sin and Darkness? This is amazing grace. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life that I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing all that you've done for me. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. This is amazing grace. Thank you, Jesus. Sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Be blessing and honor and power. Blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Sing it again. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Thank you, Father. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. To him who sits on the throne. On the throne and unto the Lamb. Be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Oh, be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Be blessing. Blessing and honor and glory and power forever. One more time. Be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. You are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Blessing and honor and glory and power. Forever. Hallelujah. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And I never ever have to be afraid. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that your love never fails, never gives up, it never runs out on me. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, we praise you, Jesus. Worship you, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, that your promises are true. Lord, you're the best friend we could ever have. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Aren't you grateful for the love of God? Amen. Praise the Lord. We're only getting to heaven because of Jesus' grace. Amen. Aren't you glad his love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on us? Amen. You know, so it's sad. So many people have had maybe a mom or dad run out on them, and you know, just been abandoned, but God doesn't ever do that. Amen. We have a faithful Father in heaven. Praise God. Praise God. Well, we need to lift up Paul and Melissa Hetzel before the Lord, and they're in need of God's provision and grace. And Donnie Henson, he's in the hospital still. Is that right, Stacy? And okay, needs prayer. And Sandra, her shoulder, she had a shoulder injury, and we need to pray the angels of the Lord just surround you, and until that time, we'll put a bunch of pillows around you, just strap them around you. Mary Hart doth good like a medicine. It's good to laugh, and also she's been dealing with migraines, and we also need to pray for Robert Harmon, and had a good visit with him in the hospital. That's Brenda's brother. She calls them both Robert and Michael, confused the tar out of me, and finally got it straightened out. And I thought she was talking about two different people all the time. Sometimes they pray for Michael, and then pray for Robert. Go visit Michael. It's like, who is it? Well, anyway, had a good visit with him in the hospital, and I don't say this to brag on me. You know, we've been praying and praying, and he said it's the first intelligent conversation he's ever had with a minister about God, and he appreciated me coming and talking with him, and so it was good. It was good. So we need to pray, you know, that he'll take that step. And amen. So, well, let's lift these up before the Lord, and you may have a need on your heart, and you just give that to the Lord as we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Oh, God. Lord, we read in the book of Revelation that, Lord, when you're revealed, Lord, your name is faithful and true. Lord, your love never gives up. Lord, it never runs out on us. You are faithful, so faithful. Thank you, Lord, that we can depend on your amazing love for us. God, no, it's not a license for us to sin. It's not a license for us to go live like the world. But Lord, it's knowing that, Lord, we are loved. We are loved. And when people do mess up and they do leave the straight and narrow, Lord, they can turn back to Jesus. They can go to the cross. And Lord, there's forgiveness, there's grace, like the prodigal son. Thank you for that, Lord. And God, we lift up Paul and Melissa before you. God, you know their needs, and decisions have been made. And Lord, they're looking to you for direction and provision. And pray your blessing and peace upon them and upon Mary, Lord. No matter how old our children are, they're still our kids. And Lord, bless her with peace and assurance. God, we lift up Glenda before you, or Donnie before you, and Lord, you know his physical need, and we pray your grace, your healing touch upon him. Lord, Glenda, I believe, is still dealing with digestive things, and just pray your healing touch upon her. Lord, we lift up Ron before you, and God, he and Sharon have not been able to come to church because he's been dealing with some things, and God, we pray for your healing touch, God, in his digestive system, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord. Others that are home today, Lord, because, Lord, they're ill, Lord, thank you that by your stripes, Lord, by your stripes, Lord, they are healed. God, that's where the healing comes from. You already paid for it, and Lord, we pray that, Holy Spirit, you'll just take that by your power and just touch their lives, God. Those who are here, and Lord, we lift up Sharon before you. God, we lift up Sandra. Lord, my wife is still dealing with chronic things. God, others who may be here dealing with things, Lord, we pray your healing touch. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that everything you have for us is a gift. It's never earned. It's never deserved. It's bought and paid for by Jesus. And so, Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for healing. Thank you for that, God. And Lord, thank you for the good conversation I had with Robert in the hospital. And Lord, they're wanting to put him on hospice. There's different things. Lord, he's really at the end of his journey on this earth. And Lord, we just pray as a church right now, God, and just agree with the family that Heavenly Father, you would just break through all that stands between him and you. And Lord, that he would put his faith in Jesus. Father God, just make Jesus so real to him. Holy Spirit, all that he has heard, all that he has learned, God, throughout the years, God, just bring it back to him, Holy Spirit. God, you know how to speak to and to hearts and minds exactly what they need to hear to just push them over into faith in Christ. And God, we pray for that, Lord. God, bless them with Christian medical team, Lord, nurses, doctors, Lord, and God, we pray that you'd save him. And Lord, any other needs that are represented here online, God, those who are watching, Jesus, we hand them to you. God, we trust you. God, we trust you, and we thank you. Thank you, Jesus, in your precious name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Praise God. Well, let's continue to bless the Lord in our giving this evening. And if you want to pray over the offering.
Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you tonight, dear God. And we pray that you would bless this offering, Father, and bless this people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Brother Jay and Beverly. Appreciate you leading us in worship tonight, and praise God. Always good to we're not being led in songs, amen. We're being led to worship our God, and it's wonderful to feel his presence. And okay, yeah, well, let me get over there so people online can hear it.
Or text me today, and Don does not have bone cancer.
Oh, well, praise the Lord.
They did a test on that, so.
Well, good. Praise God. Amen. Amen. It's always good to hear praise reports. Our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, I am excited to be in the Jesus Sermon on the Mount, and we're actually on part 11, and we're really in focusing on chapter 7. And last week in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, we learned from the Master about prayer, right? And that we don't need to, you know, if your natural way of talking is a lot of words, well, then you just be yourself and you can give God a lot of words, okay? He's not going to put the telephone in the drawer, you know, and or put it down and go take care of Africa for a little bit and come back. Oh, yep, she's still talking. And come, or he, you know. Well, it is a scientific fact that ladies, I forgot how many it is, thousands of more words a day than men do, okay? And so that is a fact. And I am one that firmly believes there is a difference between men and women in so many ways. And there is. And so, but the issue that the Lord was dealing with was that the pagans believe the more words they babble and babble and babble, that they're going to get the attention of our God. And Jesus said, no, your Father knows what you need before you ask. And so you can just be concise. And really, the Lord's Prayer that is so good, and I use it in my personal prayer time many times, and there's a lot we can learn about it. Really what the Lord was saying was, okay, over here you got all this verbiage, and then the Lord's Prayer is just really concise. And so you know what? If all you can say is, Lord, keep me safe at work. Give me wisdom while I'm there. Lord, watch over my children today. Bless them. Bless your church. You know what? That's okay. That's okay. Now, we just don't want to get lazy and say, you know, and just make it real quick and then go on. You know, God, my brother had asked, he and I were talking, and he kind of felt like, well, I just really don't need to pray for my needs because God already knows, you know, what I need. But I said, well, you know what? God still wants us to talk with him about it because he's a relational God. He wants a relationship with us. Praise the Lord. And so another thing that the Lord reminded us of in his Sermon on the Mount was that we have a Father in heaven that will never give us bad things. He's only going to give us good things. Praise the Lord. And you know, when you use that illustration, if your son asks you for a loaf of bread, you're not going to give him a rock, right? And he asks for a fish, you're not going to give him a scorpion. And so God gives good gifts. And then also, if we don't get what we're asking for, we've been asking for, God wants us to keep asking. And in the meantime, trust him. He knows better than us, right? He sees the big picture. He's wise, he's good, we are loved, and even though we don't know why there's a delay, just keep praying, amen? Keep asking. And now this evening, we're going to revisit something that Jesus had talked about. It was concerning judging others, and the first time we looked at this, it was because we were looking at our Lord saying, okay, these are the bad attitudes, the bad practices of the Pharisees, and I don't want you to be like that. I don't want you to be arrogant. Don't want you to be haughty, looking down on people. But I want us to look at, let's see, what if, okay, what if we really see somebody not living according to God's word? I mean, they're doing some outright black and white bad stuff. Does that mean we're not supposed to say, hey, they're doing bad stuff? Is that judging? Okay, is that judging? I'm sure in our lifetimes as a Christian, we have come across people that said, don't judge me. The Bible says not to judge. And you're judging me, so you be talking to me about that. You go mind your own business, right? We've all probably faced that. Well, does God really want us to be silent and not say anything when we see somebody who says they're a Christian and they're living contrary to how Christ taught us to live? Okay, so we want to see what Jesus has to say about that tonight, but let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word, Lord, and this sermon that you preached many years ago, Lord, is still relevant today. Lord, it's your word. Heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will never pass away. So, Lord, give us discernment, give us wisdom and insight. Lord, we look to you for your anointing upon me as I teach, and those of us who listen, that we would have ears to hear tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, this is Matthew chapter 7, and we're going to read verses 1 through 6. Do not judge so that you won't be judged. For you will be judged by the same standard with which you judge others, and you will be measured by the same measure you use. Why do you look at the splinter in your brother's eye, but don't notice the beam of wood in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the splinter out of your eye, and look, there's a beam of wood in your own eye? Hypocrite, first take the beam of wood out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to take the splinter out of your brother's eye. Don't give what is holy to dogs, or toss your pearls before pigs, or they will trample them under their feet, turn and tear you to pieces. I like what D.A. Carson said. He said, demands for perfection can breed judgmentalism, while demands for love can cause a chronic shortage of discernment. Okay? So if you're stressing perfection, you're going to be judgmental, but if everything is love, 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 you're going to have a shortage of discernment, right? I think that's really prevalent in the American church today. Okay, everything, love, 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 but no discernment. Well, the first part of our passage deals with the Pharisees' attitude of being judgmental, being nitpicky on people. Hey, oh, you didn't wash your hands after you came back from the marketplace. How can you call yourself a good Israelite? Right? The things that they got after Jesus for, most of those things were things that weren't in God's word. It was religious things. Well, that person's wearing shorts to church. I don't think they're saved, right? They put their arm around their boyfriend or girlfriend in church. We're going to have a talk with them afterwards, right? It's being nitpicky. It has nothing to do with the Word of God, right? Just looking down their long pharisaical noses. So along with that, there's a lack of grace to give others and a lack of seeing their heart and the work that God's doing in the person's lives. You have been around during when God was, saving hippies. There was plenty of people standing at the church door saying, you're not coming in till you shower, you shave, get some shoes on. I remember church, Stacy and I, we had visited, a friend of ours pastored in, Mooresville, Indiana, and there was a gal that had dreadlocks, and oh boy, she's got dreadlocks, she's got to be into drugs and loose and all this stuff. It's like, what in the world? That's judging. Don't even know that person. Right? Or if someone's coming to Jesus, even if they're like a pig pen from the Peanuts, they got flies going around them, praise the Lord. Now, if a Christian wants to keep coming to church like that, we'll have a talk with them, but, right? But praise the Lord. But you know what? The problem with judgmental people is that they're missing the grace of God for their own lives, and they don't have grace to give anybody else. Right? They're failing to accept that Jesus gave his life for them, and in spite of their shortcomings, in spite of all those things, God loves them in righteousness and right standing with God is a gift. Praise the Lord. Judgmental people come in two flavors. Either A, they don't believe and receive God's love and grace, so they're hard on other people, or the other group, which Jesus was dealing with, okay, we read in the Bible, is they're arrogant, they're prideful, and they're blind to their own sins. They deceptively think that they have their lives together, and of course God is pleased with them, but he is sure not pleased with you. Right? That's their attitude. And now the first part of Jesus' passage dealt with the issue. The second part the second part with throwing discernment to the curb. If Jesus was teaching never judge anybody, never make a judgment, and then he was speaking contrary to what he taught when he said this, don't give what is holy to dogs. Is he really talking about puppy dogs? He's talking about people. He's calling people dogs. Don't give what is holy to dogs. Don't toss your pearls before pigs. He's calling people dogs and pigs. The Lord. Or they'll trample them under their feet, turn and tear you to pieces. Both dogs and pigs to the Jews were unclean animals. They are undomesticated and they were dangerous. They will hurt you. So the Lord is telling, make a right judgment concerning people. They might try to harm you. You might try to give them something good from the Lord, something sacred, something holy. Tell them something about Jesus, and they're just going to turn and cause you trouble. So I don't believe Jesus is referring to a tough-looking biker dude, and it's like, oh, boy, he looks mean. I better not tell him about Jesus. No, he's not talking about that. I believe what the Lord is referring to are people who are called today trolls. Okay? They're not wanting to learn. Okay, you don't know what you ever heard? Okay, yeah, trolls. So they've surfaced online because social media has given a voice to all kinds of people in society. Even the dregs of society. You know, the Bible calls, you know, you read in the Bible, and there's people who God calls, they're no good. They're bad. The dregs of society. And what they do is they'll get on Christian sites, and they'll purposely make inflammatory statements, okay? Or some Christians might be having a good conversation, and they'll start throwing stuff in there. And they have no desire to hear what you have to say. They don't want to learn. They're just bad characters, okay? Those are pigs and dogs, okay? All you can do is, you know, pray for them. God bless you. Hope God saves you. Get off, you know? And don't even waste your time with them. And so let's read another passage in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount dealing with judging people, okay? So we're going to learn that we are to judge. We're to judge people. This is chapter 7 of Matthew, verse 15. It says, be on your guard against false prophets. Okay, false ministers, false pastors, evangelists. Okay, be on your guard who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravaging wolves. Now, look at, you'll recognize them by their fruit. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree produces good fruit, but a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree can't produce bad fruit, neither can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that doesn't produce good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire, so you will recognize them by their fruit. The Lord is saying we need to be wise and make a good judgment. So it's not being pharisaical, like, oh, you know, you should dress a little better in church, you know, you're dishonoring God, you're not a Christian, or whatever it might be. that compared to somebody who is outright, you know, bad in their character. So Scripture interprets Scripture, okay? We need to be careful that we're getting our theology from the Bible. Scripture interprets Scripture. What God gave rule in the Old Testament is the same in the New Testament, but by the testimony of two or three witnesses. You can't take one little passage of Scripture and say, oh, God enlightened me on this, and run off and build a whole theology, write a book, preach sermons, and do all this, make movies on a passage. You can't do it. That's bad theology. There's exegesis and there's eisegesis. Okay, exegesis is studying the Word of God. Okay, Sister Benisa, she did a great job. I enjoyed hearing her messages. It was right from the Word. Okay, sometimes you get evangelists, they take one little thing and they're off. It's like, where is it? There's so much going around. Folks, don't swallow the popular teachings going around hook, line, and sinker. If Jesus didn't talk about it, if the apostles didn't talk about it, or they didn't live that way, or believe that way, or pray that way, or preach that way, well then, you know what? What that person is teaching is not God's way, okay? God isn't going to hide some little secret thing in there in the Bible. Okay, no. The mystery is Jesus is for Jews and Gentiles. Okay, that's the mystery. All right? And guess what? The mystery's out of the bag. All right? So, but the point is good Bible exegesis is letting the Word of God interpret the Word of God. So, what kind of fruit is Jesus talking about? Okay, well, let's see what the Bible has to say, what kind of fruit. So we're going to go to 2 Peter chapter 2. And, how do we know if a minister or a Christian is really a servant of God? By the fruit of how they live. Okay, so this is 2 Peter chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And I should have bolded the different places in Scripture, but I'll just kind of point them out. Okay, so... Peter writes by the Holy Spirit, but there were also false prophets, okay, we can read about that in the Old Testament, and among the people, just as there will be false teachers, okay? Now look what they do. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, okay? So they come in, they're an upstanding man or woman of God, they get in position, and then they start feeding this junk to the people of God that is not according to Scripture, okay? Very, very dangerous. Okay, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Many will follow their depraved conduct and will bring the way of truth into disrepute. Okay, look at in their greed. Okay, so they're greedy. These teachers will exploit you with fabricated stories. Oh, they'll get in the pulpit and they'll... Oh boy, this encounter I had with God, or God showed me this, or God did this, or God did that. And they make up these stories, okay, to get people sucked in. Their condemnation has long been hanging over them, and their destruction has not been sleeping. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, putting them into chains of darkness to be held for judgment, if he did not spare the ancient world when he brought the flood on its ungodly people, but protected Noah, a preacher of righteousness, and seven others. If he condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah by burning them to ashes and made them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly, and if he rescued Lot, a righteous man who was distressed by the depraved conduct of the lawless, for that righteous man living among them day after day was tormented in his righteous soul by the lawless deeds he saw and heard. If this is so, then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from the trials and to hold the unrighteous for punishment on the day of judgment. This is especially true, okay, look at, here's more bad fruit, of those who follow the corrupt desires of the flesh. Okay, they're not living according to the Spirit. Okay, they're living according to the flesh. despise authority. You know what? This is a huge warning. This is a huge warning. And not everyone, but this is a huge danger sign. God will begin blessing a church. Good things are happening. The pastor's becoming well known, and all suddenly they're like, we're going to leave our denomination. We're going to leave the Assemblies of God. We're going to leave whatever. We're going independent. You know why? Because they don't want to be under authority. Okay? They don't want to be under authority. They want to do what they want to do, and now they're going to call themselves an apostle or whatever it would be. That is dangerous. Okay? Wisdom from God, the Bible says, is submissive. You can read about that in James. Okay? No. We need to be under authority. Okay, bold and arrogant. They're not afraid to heap abuse on celestial beings, yet even angels, although they are stronger and more powerful, do not heap abuse on such beings when bringing judgment on them from the Lord. But these people blaspheme in matters they do not understand. Okay, look at, they are like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct, born only to be caught and destroyed, and like animals, they too will perish. They will be paid back for the harm they have done. Their idea of pleasure is to carouse in broad daylight. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their pleasures while they feast with you. Okay, I believe it says eyes full of adultery. Yeah, with eyes full of adultery. They're amongst Christians, and Christians are having good fellowship together, and they're thinking, I'm going to try to hook up with her. Going to try to do this, going to try to do that. I mean, they're just bad. And people, these preachers, these false preachers that have fallen a lot, along with greed, there's immorality. There's all kinds of stuff going on. They never stop sinning. They seduce the unstable. They're experts in greed. There it is, money again, and a cursed brood. They have left the straight way and wandered off to follow the way of Balaam. Okay, what was Balaam's issue? Remember Balaam? Okay, what was his issue, his sin? He was sneakily getting the king to bring judgment on the Israelites, to get them to sin. Okay, what he did was he knew God's will, but because he wanted money, okay, he got around God's will and, okay, kind of found a loophole and thought he could do both. Okay, these people, they follow the straight way to go the way of Balaam. That's he who loved the wages of wickedness. But he was rebuked by his wrongdoing by a donkey, an animal without speech, who spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. Okay, not the madness that he was talking to a donkey, the madness that he was going after money instead of, you know, after the Lord. These people are springs without water, mist driven by a storm. In other words, you know when it's you plant your garden and you're really needing the rain, and you see clouds coming up, and oh, this looks good. It's going to be a nice, gentle watering on my garden, and the thing just passes over. You know, God's saying spiritually, that's what these people are. They really don't have anything spiritual to offer. They look promising, but they're not going to feed your soul. They're just after your money, okay? Blackest darkness is reserved for them, for they boast empty, boastful words, and by appealing to the lustful desires of the flesh, they entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity. Isn't that amazing? So they might preach a message that sounds like, oh, God's going to set you free, but they're in all kinds of bondage of sin, all kinds of bondage. For people are slaves of whatever has mastered them. Okay, if they have escaped the corruption of the world, okay, look at, this is a key point. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and are again entangled in it and are overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and then turn back their backs on the sacred command that was given to them or passed on to them. Of them, the Proverbs are true, a dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to her wallowing in the mud. There we go. Dogs and pigs. Dogs and pigs. And so you know what? These bad characters, they could give you a real salvation testimony on how Jesus met them and changed their lives. They can do that. They really could do that. And people could even say, oh, I remember how brother, sister, and so-and-so, they were at this church and they gave their life to Jesus, and boy, they were different. But the shame of it was they got to walking with Jesus and they turned away and they went after the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, right? The gold, the girls, and the glory, all right? Or the guys, the gold and the glory. You know, they left following Jesus. And so, folks, the Baptists don't like to hear about that. They'll say, well, that just means they weren't saved to begin with. That's not what the Bible says. Now, we don't walk on eggshells with the Lord, right? We're not like, oh, if I mess up today and then I accidentally die, you know, I might miss out with Jesus. No, we don't live like that. You know, the Bible says if we walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin, and we have fellowship with one another. So you don't have to worry about getting snafu'd at the end, like, oh, I can't wait to meet Jesus, and, you know, you know, it's not going to happen. What the Bible is talking about, and I believe it's hard to get away from God. It's hard. Jesus understands temptation. He understands living in this world. But the person who obstinately says, no, Holy Spirit, no, no preacher, no Bible, you know, no, just stiff arms God, and they're like, this is how I want to live. The Bible says that none of the righteous things they ever done are going to be remembered. That's scary. Can you imagine living for the Lord, you know, many, many years, and then you decide to turn away from God, and, you know, that person's going to get to heaven, and but Lord, I did this, this, and this. No record of it. It's gone. Just like our sins are washed away, when we turn to Jesus, when we turn away from Jesus, our righteousness is washed away. That's scary, you know. And so let's look at Jude. It's this is a shorter passage. I probably should have shortened the last one, but this is what Jude has to say. For certain individuals whose condemnation was written about long ago, have secretly slipped in among you. Okay, again, they're secretly slipping in, okay? They are ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into a license for immorality. That happens today. God loves me. I have grace, and so I can live my life however I want. Don't judge me when the Bible is saying you can't live like that. Turns the grace of God into a license for immorality and denying Jesus Christ, our sovereign and Lord. You know what I believe that means? I don't believe they're saying, oh, I don't believe in Jesus anymore. They're denying his sovereignty. Okay, I want Jesus as my Savior, but I'm denying him as my Lord. He's not going to direct my life. He's not going to tell me how I can live and not live, okay? And so, again, we see that in our country. Though you already know all this, I want to remind you that the Lord at one time delivered his people out of Egypt, but later destroyed those who did not believe, okay? In other words, they didn't trust the Lord and they just sinned, okay? And the angels who did not keep their positions of authority but abandoned their proper dwelling, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. In similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve an example of those who will suffer the punishment of eternal fire. Okay, God loves people. God loves people. And the message that is being preached today, that you can, you know, that, God blesses homosexual marriages and that was a thing of the past. Folks, this is New Testament. This is New Testament, okay? It's not God's design. Does God love people? Yes, he does. But either Jesus is your Lord or he's not. Amen? Okay. In the very same way, on the strength of their dreams, these ungodly people pollute their own bodies, again, reject authority and heap abuse on celestial beings. But even the archangel Michael, when he was disputing with the devil about the body of Moses, did not himself dare to condemn him for slander, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Yet these people slander whatever they do not understand, and the very things they do understand by instinct as irrational animals do will destroy them. Woe to them. Okay, look, they have taken the way of Cain. Okay, what was Cain's issue? What's that? What did Cain do? Okay, murdered his brother because his brother was right in God's sight and he wasn't. Look at the vile, vile hate of people in our country. You know, if you are not for homosexual marriage and you are not for transgenderism and if you're not for abortion, these people, everything but they are just, you know, it's not like, okay, well, because Christians aren't like beating them on the heads and saying this, but it's like they're doing everything but their head turned around and them spitting green. I mean, it's... they are just nasty, vile. They give death threats and, you know, I'm going to do this to your children and this and that. And it's like, you people are crazy. They're just, it's just vile, wicked, evil. Yeah, they've gone away, but the scripture's talking about preachers being like this. I don't like you because you're wanting to live for Jesus. You're wanting to live according to the Bible. They have rushed again. Okay, here we are into Balaam's error, okay, choosing money. Okay, what was Korah's? Well, spoiler, rebellion. They've been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. Okay, these people are rebellious. And these people are blemishes at your love feast, eating with you without the slightest qualm, shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds without rain, blown along by the wind, autumn trees without fruit, uprooted, twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea, foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom blackest darkness has been reserved forever. And I think I may have put in more of the scripture than I wanted to. What verse am I on? Okay. Okay, Enoch, might as well keep going. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all of them of all the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness and of all the defiant words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. All right, these people are grumblers and fault finders. They follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves, flatter others for their advantage. Okay, so the fruit Jesus is referring to is really clear. Okay, really clear. The Lord wants us to take notice of the fruit. Take notice of the fruit. We do need to judge people. There might be people in a congregation, you know, they may have been in a congregation for years, but, you know, they're, you know, grumblers, fault finders, divisive people. That's bad fruit. That's bad fruit. Slanderers, manipulators, liars. And so the Lord wants us to notice their fruit and call them what they are. This is making a right judgment. It's not being judgmental. It's saying this is a bad character. Okay. And so what about those whose ministry seem to be really blessed by God? Things are really happening. Okay. Well, you know what? Anointing doesn't equal approval. Okay, just as grace given for them to repent doesn't equal approval. Okay? You can read about Jezebel in the book of Revelation. He says, I have given her time to repent, but she refuses, so I'm going to cast her and her children on a bed of suffering. People on both ends, the one who has gotten off the straight and narrow and their followers, they misunderstand God's grace. Just because things are going well for you doesn't mean you got God's blessing. Do you know that the northern kingdom of Israel, while the prophets were preaching and warning them, do you know they were going through a huge period of prosperity? Man, they were living good. They had lots of money. Things were going really well for them. And many of us, we think that they totally got rid of the Lord, okay? But what they did is they took Baal worship and the Ashtaroths and all this other stuff, and they just included it with God. And they have, even recently, it was like a year or two ago, Israelites, the archaeologists dug up these bowls that had both things about Yahweh and also Baal on these household bowls people had in their... So they were like worshiping both, and so just because things are going well doesn't mean that God's approval is there. Okay, we need to. And on the flip side, you know what? If you're a Christian, you're living for Jesus, and your life is going rough, it doesn't mean that you have God's disapproval either. Okay, and so. I think I quoted this before. Hilton Griswold, Larry Griswold's dad, he said this: I believe when a minister goes astray, the devil stops his hindrance on their ministry and allows it to get really big, so that when they're discovered and they fall, it will cause the greatest amount of harm in the kingdom of God. So he's like, the devil's just going to say, oh, I got him. There goes a Balaam. There goes a Korah. There goes a Cain. There goes a deceiver. They're returning to the vomit. Okay, pals, you know, the fellow demons, back off. Let it grow. Let their ministry just grow, and then crash. You know, it's the major media ministries that fell in the 80s, I mean, did so much harm to the church in America. And now, just as a side note, there's ministries today, they're really annoying. They're self-appointed watchmen to warn the church, okay? And their attitudes are so unchrist-like, they're critical, they're nitpicky, and you know what? That's not the Spirit of God. You know, the Bible says there's only one accuser of the brethren in the Bible. You know who that is? What's that? No, accuser of the brethren. Satan. And so these Christians, okay, and I'm not saying they're not saved, but their attitudes are unchristlike. Do you know, okay, and I know we've sung it in this church. Let's see, draw me close to you, never let me go. Okay, these nitpicking just critical-spirited people. Do you know that when that song came out, because when I was pastoring in my previous church, there were people saying, well, I don't think we should sing that because, and they were going by these so-called ministers that said, well, how do you know you're singing about Jesus? Because Jesus or God isn't even mentioned in there. And so maybe it's like just the guy wrote it for his girlfriend or something or whatever. And I'm like, well, that's stupid. Every time, you know, if you turn to the one you love, okay, now Sherman, when you turn to Pat and you just say all kinds of wonderful things and I love you, but you don't say her name, she's not going to say, are you talking about me? you didn't say my name. Isn't that dumb? But these people who are so critical, they nitpick every little tiny thing. And it's like, that is not the Lord. It is not the Lord. And like I said, I'm not doubting their salvation, but that's not the Spirit of God, okay, to have a critical, nitpicky spirit. So we don't want syrupy love where we just approve everything, okay? Neither does the Lord want us to have a critical spirit, but like the Lord put, we look at their fruit, okay? What kind of fruit do these people have? Let's see. We need to make a right judgment based on the fruit. Okay, do they have a lot of money or are they living for money? There's a big difference. Okay? I see nothing wrong in the Bible about Christians or ministers having a lot of money. Okay? And I can confidently say it because we don't have a lot of money. Okay? So it's not like, well, you know, I'm trying to pad myself here. Okay, are they living a clean life or are they immoral? Do their teachings contradict the Lord's message of the Bible? Okay, there's a difference between being a heretic and being off on a matter. That's another thing too. It's like, you know, preachers aren't perfect either, and they might say something a little off, but these critical ministries, man, that's like, boom, they're not a real pastor. They're not a child of God. They're of the devil. You can find YouTube videos about how Billy Graham is of the devil. It's like, isn't that dumb? And so, but look at the people. Are they proud or are they humble? You know, we look at that. Let's see. There was some things I had skipped over, but. So those who were anointed and given a ministry and have been used by God but turn to live in sin are going to be greatly, greatly surprised. Okay, they can fool themselves, they can fool other people, you cannot fool the Lord. This is in the Sermon on the Mount, right after Jesus talked about, you'll know the trees by their fruit. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. Sounds like a charismatic Pentecostal ministry to me. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evil doers. Wow. Wow. Anointing, ministry, success does not equal God's approval. It doesn't. We judge by the book. Jeremiah would have been a failure. The whole nation, he lost everybody. That preacher lost his whole congregation, all right? They all went into exile. But he was a success in God's eyes. And so we need to be careful. So just be very, very careful, you know, popular people who are out there, books, and they're on the internet and on whatever, it's like, judge them by the word. What are they really preaching? Okay, how are they really living? And so we're going to all stand before the Lord. But anyway, with that, let's all stand before the Lord. We're gonna close in prayer. And this is a message I don't think I can give an altar call for, but if you want to come to the altar, you're welcome. But praise the Lord. Let's pray. Ah, praise you, Lord. Lord Jesus, I give you praise that you are a God of righteousness, that you're a God of truth. Lord, yes, you are a God of love and you're a God of mercy. But Lord, you don't change. Lord, your way is straight, your way is narrow, and Lord, it's through you, Jesus. It's the way of holiness, not man-made holiness, but Lord, it's true holiness, Lord, living an upright, righteous, pure life in your sight. God, thank you that there's forgiveness. Lord, thank you that, Lord, however people can blow it and go astray, Lord, thank you. There's always the call to come back. Lord, that's your heart. That's your heart, Lord, the heart of the Father looking for the prodigal to return. Lord, the coin that's been dropped and lost in the dirty earth, Lord, you're finding it. Lord, that one sheep that got distracted and wandered away, Lord, you're looking for that sheep. Lord, thank you, God. So this isn't a message to bash people over the head, but Lord, this is your word. Lord, I'm re-preaching your sermon, and Lord, you told us to make a right judgment. God, so when people say they're righteous, and people say they're Christians, and people say that they're a pastor, or evangelist, minister, but Lord, they are not living a godly life, Lord, we can say that person is a sheep in wolf's clothing. God, we can take your word and we can judge, Lord, how they're living and what they're preaching by your book. God, thank you for that. God, give us wisdom. Give us discernment. And Lord, keep us, Lord, from also having a critical spirit. God, that's not of you. Lord, your grace. You're full of grace. And so, God, give your people grace. Give your people wisdom. Help us to make right judgments. And Lord, if any of us have been pharisaical, Lord, I pray that you would reveal that to us. And Lord, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Lord, bless us as we leave tonight. Bring us back safely on Sunday. And we love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you.